Hello and welcome to the science class. My name is Teacher John. This morning we are going to look at endoparasites, that is primary 5 term 3, P5 term 3. In our previous lesson we looked at types of parasites and we said we have two types of parasites. We have endoparasites and ectoparasites. Ectoparasites are external parasites. They live on bodies of animals. They are also known as external parasites. Then we have endoparasites. They are also known as internal parasites. They live inside the bodies of animals. So you can say these are parasites. These are parasites. These are parasites that live inside the bodies of animals. These are parasites that live inside the bodies of animals. They are called endoparasites. We have examples. Examples of endoparasites or internal parasites. Examples of endoparasites. Examples of endoparasites. One, we have tapeworms. Number two, we have liver flukes. Number three, we have roundworms. These are examples of internal parasites, also known as endoparasites. Why are tapeworms called endoparasites? Question. Why are tapeworms? Why are tapeworms called endoparasites? Can say tapeworms. Tapeworms live inside the bodies of animals. Tapeworms live inside the bodies of animals. That's why they are called endoparasites. Because we say endoparasites are parasites that live inside the bodies of animals. And tapeworms, liver flukes, and the roundworms live inside the bodies of animals. That's why they are called endoparasites or internal parasites. How to control endoparasites? How can we control internal parasites? How to control endoparasites? How to control endoparasites? Now, internal parasites can be controlled in the following ways. One is by deworming. We talked about deworming. Two, by giving animals clean food.
by giving animals clean food. Giving animals clean food. 3, by giving animals clean water. By giving animals clean water. So if you have goats and sheep, you deworm them, give them clean water, and give them clean food. You'll be controlling internal parasites. Then, how can you control external parasites? How to control external parasites? How to control external parasites? How to control external parasites? External parasites can be controlled in very many ways. One, by dipping. By dipping. Number 2, by spraying. By spraying. Number 3, by hand-picking ticks. By hand-picking ticks. Or you can say the ticking. Then by paddocking. By paddocking. So these are different ways of controlling external parasites. Even by using egrets. By using egrets. By using egrets. Now egrets are birds. Especially they are, most of them are white. They are always seen where animals feed from. When animals are eating food or grass in the field or in the bush, you always find these animals on top of these. You always find these birds called egrets on top of animals eating ticks. They are white birds. Even if you go to the game park, you find that egrets are always on top of animals when they are eating grass. So those egrets, they are birds that eat external parasites on animals. So when they eat ticks and other parasites, external parasites, they control them. So that's one way of controlling external parasites. So if goats and sheep are grazing in the field and these birds come where they are grazing from and they go on top of these animals, they start eating ticks and other external parasites. That is one way of controlling external parasites. And these birds are called egrets, not rats. Then we have paddocking. Paddocking is a method of grazing animals where animals are put in different paddocks or in different sections or plots. You have a big land like this one. Then you divide this land into sections. So we have section A, section B, C and D. So you can keep your goats in A or your sheep in A. Then when they eat grass here and it's done, you take them to B. Then from B you take them to C, from C you take them to D. This one is called paddocking method. And this method helps to control ticks. How? It breaks the life cycle of ticks. As simple as that. So that's how we control external parasites and internal parasites. Let's look at effects of parasites on animals. Effects of parasites on animals. Effects of parasites on animals. Effects of parasites effects of parasites on animals. So how do these parasites affect animals? Some of them suck blood, like sassafras, like ticks. So that's how they affect animals. They suck blood from animals. Number two, apart from sucking blood, they also spread diseases. They spread diseases to animals. They damage the skin, especially ticks. They damage the skin of animals. E.g. ticks. Ticks damage the skin of animals. So they damage the skin of animals. They spread diseases to animals. For example, we have diseases which are spread by ticks, like heart water, red water, East Coast fever, anaplasmosis. We have diseases, a disease which is spread by sassaflies, like Nagana. Nagana is spread by sassaflies. So these parasites, they spread diseases to animals. Then they also destroy the skin, or they damage the skin of animals. Then they also they like tapeworms. They feed on digested food. So these animals grow thinner. They make animals. These parasites prevent proper growth of animals. These animals grow when they are thin. They prevent proper growth. They prevent proper growth of animals. They prevent proper growth of animals. How do they prevent proper growth? When they suck digested food. So instead of animals using the food they eat, tapeworms eat this food and the animals become thinner and smaller, because the food they eat is being consumed by tapeworms. So you find that these parasites make these animals grow poorly. That's why here we are saying they prevent proper growth of animals. So that's how parasites affect animals. That is how parasites affect animals. Let's look at products got from sheep. Products got from sheep and goats. Shall begin with goats or begin with sheep. Products got from goats. What do we get from goats? 1. Milk. 2. More hair. 3. Skins. 4. Manure. These are products. Then we have meat, goat meat. We get meat from goats. So these are products we get from goats. Milk, more hair. More hair is the hair we get from goats. especially Angora goats. Angora goats, they provide more hair. Then these goats provide milk, they provide meat, provide skins and manure.
Our goats give us our droppings, and those droppings, when they decompose, they give us farmyard manure.
So that's, those are the products we get from goats. Angora goats. Angora goats provide more hair. Angora goats provide more hair.
This more hair can be used in industries, textile industries, to make jackets, blankets, clothes, and so on.
Then we look at products got from sheep.
Products got from sheep.
Products got from sheep. So what we get from sheep? One, we get mutton. And mutton
is the meat got from
sheep. Number two, we get wool. We get wool from sheep.
We get wool from sheep. Then we also get skins. Skins.
Skins. We have manure. We have hooves. These hooves are used to make glue. We have horns. The horns are used to make buttons. Horns are used to make buttons.
So these are products got from sheep and goats. So we are done with that. Then next we look at piggery. 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 Now, when you're talking about piggery, we are looking at keeping pigs. That's what piggery is about. And a piggery is a farm of pigs. A farm of pigs is known as piggery.
You can say piggery is a farm of pigs. Piggery is a farm of pigs.
You want to make correction in your booklet on page 26. In this booklet, it is saying piggery is keeping of pigs. That's not right. So change it and say piggery is a farm of pigs. Piggery is a farm of pigs, not rearing of pigs. So change that. Piggery is a farm of pigs. Then why do people keep pigs?
Reasons for keeping pigs.
Reasons why people keep pigs.
Reasons why people keep pigs. Reasons why people keep pigs. Reasons why people keep pigs. Why do people keep pigs? One, people keep pigs to get pork. One is to get pork. Pork is meat. We meat from pigs. People keep pigs to get pork. Then, number two, pigs are a source of income when sold. So to get income. To get income, because we can sell pigs and we get money. To get income when we sell pigs. Then, some people keep pigs as pets. Some people, okay, before that, you can say to get Bristol hair. To get Bristol hair. Now, the hair we get from pigs is called Bristol hair. Explain the word Bristol, please. Bristol hair. Bristol hair. This is the hair got from pigs, and this hair is used to make toothbrushes. It's called Bristol hair. It is got from pigs. So people keep pigs to get Bristol hair. Then I say, some people keep pigs as pets, especially piglets. Some people keep pigs. Some people keep pigs as pets. Some people keep pigs as pets. The way you keep rabbits as pets, the way you keep dogs as pets, the way you keep cats as pets. There are people who keep pigs as pets, especially piglets. They can keep them as pets. So those are some of the reasons why people keep pigs. Then we look at the importance of pigs. How are pigs important? All uses of pigs. Uses of pigs to people. Uses of pigs to people. One, they provide pork. They provide pork. Number two, they provide Bristol hair. They provide Bristol hair. Number three, they provide income when sold. They provide income when sold. They provide income when sold. That's how pigs are important to people. Then, we have terms that are used in piggery. Terms that are used in piggery. Terms that are used in piggery. Before that, we also have what we call lard. Pigs provide lard. They provide lard. Lard are fats got from pigs. They provide lard or fats. They provide lard or fats. So pigs have a lot of fats, and those fats from pigs are called lard. So we look at terms that are used in piggery. You may go on a farm of pigs, and then they ask you some of, you need to know some of the terms that are used in piggery. Terms used in piggery. Terms used in piggery. And that's what we say. Piggery is a farm of pigs where they keep pigs. That place where they keep pigs is called piggery, not rearing of pigs. I told you to change that. It is in your booklet. So we shall begin by looking at boar. Boar. Boar is a male pig. Boar is male pig. A male pig is called boar. So if you go on a piggery farm and you hear somebody talk of boar, just know they are referring to a male pig. Then we have sow. Sow is a female pig. Number two, we have sow. Female pig. Female pig. A female pig is known as sow. Then we have gilt. 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 Three. We have gilt. Gilt is a young female pig. Gilt is a young female pig. A young female pig is called gilt. Then we have piglet. Piglet. Piglet is a young pig. Or the young one of a pig. Young one of a pig. Young one of a pig is called a piglet. Young one of a pig is known as a piglet. Then we have what's called pork. Pork is meat from pig. Or the meat of a pig is called pork. Meat of a pig. The meat of a pig is called pork. Number six, we have what's called lard. Lard. I've just talked about lard. Lard, these are fats from pigs. Fats from pigs. Fats from pigs are called lard. Then we have farrowing. Farrowing. Farrowing is double R. Is the act. The act of giving birth. The act of giving birth. The act of giving birth to piglets. The act of giving birth to piglets by a sow. Remember, I told you a sow is a female pig. So the act of giving birth to piglets by a sow is called farrowing. Then we have what you call hog. Hog is a castrated pig. Hog, not this. Hog is a castrated pig. There are people who say castrated male pig. It's the same. Because you cannot castrate a female pig. You only castrate male pigs. So I don't need to say
a castrated male pig.
Because we don't have a castrated female pig. No. So he simply said, hog is a castrated pig. Because we only castrate male, cannot castrate female. Female, they don't have what to castrate. So we simply say castrated pig is called hog. Then we look at breeds of pigs. Breeds of pigs. Or types of breeds. Yes, we mean by that. Types of breeds of pigs. Types of breeds of pigs. Types of types of breeds of pigs. Of pigs. Types of breeds of pigs. Now one, we have exotic breeds. Number two, we have local breeds. Then we have cross breeds. These cross breeds are also known as hybrids. Then we have wild pigs like Watham. Wild pigs like a Watham. Wild pig, e.g. Watham. So those are the types of breeds of pigs. So these are types of breeds of pigs. Exotic breeds, local breeds, cross breeds, then wild pigs. Wild pigs, e.g. Wasog. So a Wasog is a pig that is wild. It lives in the bush. That's why it is called wild. It cannot be domesticated. So all of you know Wasogs, how they look like. They are wild pigs. So we look at local breeds of pigs. Local breeds of pigs. Local breeds of pigs. Now these are breeds that originate in Uganda or in Africa. That's why they are called local breeds or indigenous breeds. We have examples like black pigs and old spotted pigs. Black pigs, those pigs which are black. Black pigs, they are local breeds. They are called black pigs. Then number two, we have old spotted pigs. So these are pigs with a lot of spots and colors in them. Old spotted pigs, they have spots. When I say they have spots, it simply means that they have some dotted colors. May find it is black, but it has some spots or color in it. So those are the two examples of local breeds. Let's look at characteristics of local breeds of pigs. Characteristics of local breeds. Characteristics of local breeds of pigs. Characteristics of local breeds of pigs. So local breeds of pigs, they have the following characteristics. One, they are small in size. They are small in size. Number two, they are more resistant to diseases. They are more resistant to diseases, meaning that they don't easily fall sick. They resist diseases. They are more resistant to harsh weather. They are more resistant to harsh weather. They are more resistant to harsh weather conditions. Then they grow slowly. They produce poor quality pork. Their pork is very fake and poor. They produce poor quality pork. They are more resistant to parasites and diseases. Then, a question: how can we improve local breeds of pigs? Question: How can we improve the quality? How can we improve the quality of local breeds of pigs? How can we improve the quality of local breeds of pigs? How can we improve the quality of local breeds of pigs? We can improve the quality of local breeds of pigs by crossbreeding. By crossbreeding, that is how we can improve the quality of local breeds. And crossbreeding is mating local breeds with exotic breeds. NB. Crossbreeding is mating of local breeds with exotic breeds. netting of local breeds with exotic breeds.
That's what you call crossbreeding. So you can improve the quality of local breeds by crossbreeding. In other words, by mating local breeds with exotic breeds. That is how we can improve the quality of local breeds. Then next we look at exotic breeds. And these are breeds that were imported into Uganda because of their good qualities. They have good qualities. And that's why they were imported. They don't originate in Uganda. They were just brought in Uganda because they have good qualities. So exotic breeds. Exotic breeds of pigs. Exotic breed of pigs. One, we have what we call large white. Large white. We have Landrace. Landrace. Then we have Wessex saddleback. Wessex. Wessex saddleback. This one originates in England. In England, there's a place called Wessex. Wessex saddleback. Then we have another one called Middle White. Middle White. Number five, we have Large Black. Large Black. Number six, we have Poland China. Poland China. These are originates from China. That's why it's called Poland China. Okay, characteristics of exotic breeds. Characteristics of exotic breeds of pigs. Characteristics. Characteristics of exotic breeds of pigs. Characteristics of exotic breeds of pigs. So exotic breeds of pigs have the following characteristics. One, they grow faster or they grow quickly. They grow quickly. Then number two, they are big in size. They are big. They are big in size. Then, so we say they are big in size. They produce high quality pork. They produce high quality. They produce high quality pork. They produce high quality pork. They are less resistant to diseases. They are less resistant to diseases, meaning that they easily get diseases. They are easily attacked by diseases. That's what we mean by they are less resistant to diseases. Then we have wild pigs. Wild pigs are commonly found in the bush. Write something about wild pigs. Wild pigs. They are commonly found in the wild. They are commonly found in the bush or in the wild.
commonly found in the bush or wild.
That's why they are called wild pigs.
An example is the warthog. Example examples of wild pigs. We have warthog. Warthog. So warthog is a wild pig.
Then we said crossbreeds are pigs got after mating local breeds with exotic breeds.
Crossbreeds. Crossbreeds, also known as hybrids. Hybrids. These are breeds got by mating local breeds with exotic breeds. These are breeds got by mating local breeds with exotic breeds.
As simple as that. So that is all about breeds of So that one marks the end of our lesson. May the Almighty God bless you abundantly.